anything's possible by the power of the Holy Ghost. A new wind is blowing right now, breaking my heart of stone, taking over like it's Jericho, and my walls are all crashing down.
One of my favorite stories, I say that often, but when we talk about King David, as a child, I loved reading about King David. I had this book. There were Old Testament stories, and this is what truly started my love affair with the Old Testament, is there's these books, and it had a tape player. And it read you the book, and you're able to read the words, look at the picture, and when the chime chimed, you turn the page. And I would sit next to this orange tape player and just play all these Old Testament books. And the story of King David, or at the time, David and Jonathan, I just fell in love with. About these two men who were just closer than brothers. They showed true love for each other and what that cost them. So we're going to read 35 verses. I know it's a lot, but to truly understand this whole story, I think we need to do that. And so this is the background. David is serving in the palace of King Saul. And King Saul has made some really poor decisions about his relationship with God. And Samuel said to King Saul, he said, the kingdom that God has given you is going to be given to another. It's going to be torn out of your hands and given to another. God is replacing you. And he's no longer going to be with you. And at that time, Saul lost his relationship with God. David, all of a sudden, who was serving in Saul's army, was revered and looked upon. Saul was jealous. He would have evil spirits come upon him, and David would play the harp, and it would calm Saul. But Saul decided that David was a threat, and saw that the hand of God was on David, and so Saul tried to kill David multiple times. And in 1 Samuel chapter 19, verse 9, it says this, now a distressing spirit from the Lord came upon Saul as he sat in his house with his spear in his hand, and David was playing music with his hand. Then Saul sought to pin David to the wall with his spear, but he slipped away from Saul's presence, and he drove the spear into the wall. So David fled and escaped that night. And so at this time, David's on the run, and he's running from Saul, and Saul goes, you know what, I'm going to set a trap for him at his house. But David escapes. And David's on the run. And then we pick it up in chapter 20, verse 1. Then David fled from Naoth in Ramah and went and said to Jonathan, what have I done? What is my iniquity? And what is my sin before your father that he seeks my life? So Jonathan said to him, by no means, you shall not die. Indeed, my father will do nothing, neither great or small, without first telling me. And why should my father hide this thing from me? It is not so. Then David took an oath again and said, your father certainly knows that I have found favor in your eyes. And he has said, do not let Jonathan know this, lest he be grieved. But truly, as the Lord lives, and as your soul lives, there is but a step between me and death. So Jonathan said to David, whatever you yourself desire, I will do it for you. Then David said to Jonathan, indeed, tomorrow is the new moon, and I shall not fail to sit with your king to eat, or sit with the king to eat. But let me go that I may hide in the field until the third day at evening. If your father misses me at all, then say, David earnestly asked permission of me that he might run over to Bethlehem, his city, for there is a yearly sacrifice for all the family. If he says thus, it is well, your servant will be safe. But if he is very angry, be sure that evil is determined by him. Therefore you shall deal kindly with your servant, for you have brought your servant into a covenant of the Lord with you. Nevertheless, if there is iniquity in me, kill me yourself, for why should you bring me to your father? But Jonathan said, far be it from you, for if I knew certainly that evil was determined by my father to come upon you, then would I not tell you? Then David said to Jonathan, who will tell me, or what will your father answer you roughly? And Jonathan said to David, come, let us go into the field. So both of them went into the field. Then Jonathan said to David, the Lord God of Israel is witness. Then I have sounded out my father sometime tomorrow or the third day, and indeed there is good toward David, and I will not send it to you and tell you. May the Lord do so, and much more to Jonathan, if it please my father to do you evil, then I will report it to you and send you away, that you may go in safety. and the Lord will be with you, and he has been with my father, and you shall not only show me kindness of the Lord while I still live, that I may not die, but you shall not cut off your kindness from my house forever, nor not when the Lord has cut off every one of the enemies of David from the face of the earth. So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, the Lord require it, and the hand of David's enemies. We're going to stop there for a second so I can kind of sum up what's going on. Because a lot of times when you're reading, and someone's reading to you, if you're like my wife Katie, she's sick right now, she's not able to be here, but she can't have someone read to her. And she goes, John, what are you reading? And I tell her, she says, just give me your phone. Why did you ask? Just ask for my phone. But this is what's going on. David is fleeing for his life, and he goes to his friend Jonathan and says, listen, your dad wants to kill me. Jonathan goes, what are you talking about? Yeah, that's foolishness. And he goes, listen, your dad doesn't want to make you upset, so he's hiding from you, but he wants to kill me. And I'm supposed to be with your dad for the new moon festival. So let's do this. Tell your dad I'm not going to be there. And after 1 or 2 days, 3 days max, if he's angry, he says, hey, don't worry, I'm glad he's with his family. No harm is meant. But if he gets upset, he wants to kill me. And you need to let me know. And Jonathan goes, David, no matter if it's good news or bad news, I'm going to let you know because I love you. But this one thing I ask, that God is giving you the kingdom. I can see that. He got his hands upon you. Can you deal kindly with me and my family after I'm gone? And that's where we're going to pick up in verse 17. Now Jonathan again caused David to bow because he loved him, and he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan said to David, tomorrow's a new moon, and you will be missed, because your seat will be empty. And when you have stayed 3 days, go down quickly and come to the place where you hid on the day of the deed, and remain by the stone Ezel. Then I'll shoot 3 arrows to the side, as though I shot at a target, and there I will send the lad, saying, go, find the arrows. If I expressly say to the lad, look, the arrows are on the side of you, get them and come. Then, as the Lord lives, there is safety for you and no harm. But if it is thus to the young man, look, the arrows are beyond you. Go your way, for the Lord has sent you away, and for the matter which I have spoken of, indeed, the Lord be between you and me forever. And we're going to stop there, actually. They came up with a plan, just like two friends would do, a secret code, that if the arrows were shot to the side, David would be safe. If the arrows were shot further off, and the lad was told, hey, they're further beyond, David knew that it was unsafe and that Saul truly wanted to kill him. And what we're not reading is that, sure enough, Saul got angry. And not only got angry at David, but got angry at Jonathan and tried to kill Jonathan. And Jonathan let David know that they embraced and they parted ways. And the next time David sees Jonathan, it is at his funeral. And it's a sad story, but also a story of great love. And before we get into it, let's say a prayer. Father God, as we look at love, like, and hate, open our eyes, open our hearts to what you have to show us. That way we may live according to your word. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. This story between Jonathan and David, there's a lot of intricate parts, and we have to understand a little bit more than what this story is telling us. And the first is, Jonathan is next in line to be king. We have to understand that Jonathan is next in line to king, but he knows that Saul is being replaced by David. And so Saul isn't just losing a job, he's losing a kingdom. I can't imagine what it must be growing up saying, you're the next king. You're the next king. Or you can look at it as you know, I secretly follow the royals. And you have Queen Elizabeth, and you have Prince Charles. He must think, one day I'm going to be king. And he's 40 years old, oh, pretty soon I'm going to be king. 60-year-olds, pretty soon I'm going to go, man, I don't know if I'm going to be king anymore. And Queen Elizabeth, she just keeps on going. Prince Charles, he's probably not going to be the next king. That must have been a devastating thought for him, to think that his son was going to be king. It skipped a generation. But to know your enemy, or your father's enemy, your best friend, is being chosen over you, and you're losing everything. You're losing your house, your livelihood, an inheritance, a kingdom, respect, glory, honor, is just literally being taken away by your friend. And that, if that doesn't cause someone to hate, you know, I don't know what would. We know that people hate for a lot less than that. You stole my girlfriend. Hate you forever. You stole my boyfriend. I mean, things like that. We see that in middle school all the time, in high school, in college. My friend Dave and I, we both like the same girl, Amy Finch. And we have no clue whatever happened to Amy Finch, but we liked the same girl, and we tried to date her, and she didn't like either of us. And but we were angry that he asked her out, and I asked her out. Now, she did tell me that I was a hot dog and she was a steak, and then she liked steaks. And I'm like, oh, the tube steak? And it didn't work. But the reality is this. Jonathan had every reason to hate David, but he chose to love David. And what is love? The first thing that we notice about love is love involves others. When we love, it involves others. You do not live in a box. You do not live in a vacuum. You cannot say love if you're only loving yourself. Love always involves others. The focus is never you. It's always someone else. The focus on Jonathan wasn't him. Jonathan could have easily killed David. He had a bow and arrow. He knew where David was hiding. He could have shot David at any time. He could have killed David, but instead he loved David. His focus wasn't on what Jonathan was losing, but was on the trouble that David was facing. The focus was never on himself. When we love, it involves others, and the focus is always someone else. Always. It's never on you. Love is not understood. It isn't. Gentlemen who are married, look, if your wife is here, look at your wife. If she's not, think about your wife. Why does she love you? Like when I'm walking down the beach hand in hand with Katie, they must think either he's wealthy or she's on drugs. Like, that's what they're doing. I don't know why you guys are laughing so hard. All right? But it baffles me why Katie would choose me as her husband. But she did. Love doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense that Jonathan was trading his kingdom for a friend. It doesn't make sense that he didn't do everything to stop it. If you're going to lose your job to a friend, wouldn't you do everything to keep that job? Of course you would. It's your job. If you're going to lose your house, wouldn't you do everything you can to keep your house? But yet, Jonathan willingly gave it all away for love. Love does not make sense. Love changes everything. It changed his relationship, Jonathan's relationship with his father. After this, Saul's rage was poured out on Jonathan. He wanted to kill his son. Love doesn't make sense. It changes everything. Love is also a choice. It is not something that comes naturally for us. In the Old Testament, there the word for love is it's a choice. It's a covenant relationship. God has made a choice to love us. He's made a covenant with us. It is a choice He willingly made. You know, a lot of people say, oh, I fell in love. No, you fell in lust. You choose to love. Because you don't fall out of love. You can fall out of lust easily. You don't fall in love. You fall into lust. You choose to love. Love is always a choice. Now, does that mean you should not tell your wife, oh, I fell in love with you? No, we understand what we're saying. But love is a choice. God chose to love us. And that choice is such a powerful choice, is that when we sin against Him, when we spit in His face, when we just say, God, I reject you, he still chooses to love us because it is a choice he is making. Love is a choice. And because of that, we have the ability to choose not to love. And how, what does it say about Jonathan? That he chose to love David. The enemy of his family, he chose to love. Even at his own cost. Because love also carries a heavy cost. Because of the love Jonathan had for David, it cost Jonathan everything. It cost Jonathan everything. It was a sacrifice. It was painful. My dad, he spanked me. My mom spanked me. She swears she did not break a wooden spoon on me. She broke a wooden spoon on me. And I know she watches these videos. Mom, you broke this wooden spoon on me. And they deny it. But my parents, they loved me. And sometimes it caused me physical pain because I was disobedient. But having children of my own, it's a lot more painful to spank my children than it is for them to receive a spanking. It is horrible. Luckily, we have my daughter, Grace. She is absolutely wonderful. She's a very well-behaved daughter, and I spanked her 3 times in her life. But each time, I vividly remember and knowing that it hurt me more than it would hurt her. Love hurts. There's a sacrifice. It's painful. Jonathan loved David and he sacrificed his relationship with his dad. It was painful for his dad to try to kill him. I can't imagine my dad, even in his rage, trying to kill me. I can't fathom that. Jonathan experienced that because he chose to love. Love also has results. People's lives are changed. Sometimes we don't see the results right away. What's interesting about the story of David and Jonathan is that David made a covenant that he would watch out for the family, of Jonathan's family. Jonathan had a son whose legs were broken not because of a deformity, but because he was dropped when he was a baby. And you know what David did? When he became king, he took that son and made him eat at the king's table every day. And took care of him. Love has far-reaching results. The love that David had for Jonathan lasted through the years and affected his children. You don't think people knew that Jonathan's son was sitting at the table of King David? And if you know anything about kingdoms, if you say, well, Saul's the rightful king of Israel, so that means Jonathan is the rightful king. That means Jonathan's son is the rightful king. That is an enemy to the kingdom of David. But love ignored all of that and brought the heir to a fallen kingdom to sit at the table of the new kingdom. David loved and ignored everything, and it changed people's lives. You don't think people saw that and said, hey, there's something there. Why would he do that? Because of love. Love changes lives. It doesn't change our life only. It changes others. And we don't even see. We will never see the results. Sometimes we do, but a lot of times we never will. We'll never see what other people see. And they change it. We had our missionary here last week, David Ross. He's our new association missionary. And I was meeting with him Saturday, and he said, you know, you have a wonderful church. And I'd be surprised if any association member said, man, your church stinks, John. But he said, we have a wonderful church. He said, yes. He said, one thing I noticed about your church, you guys really love each other. Other people see our love. It affects others. So 5 things that we see about love. Love involves others. Love is not understood. Love is a choice. Love carries a heavy cost. And love has results. But those are the simple facts about love. But to have love, you need to have hate. We will never understand love without understanding the opposite of love. Like, you never know how it feels to be accepted until you were truly rejected. Now, think about it this way. We experience God's love, right? Because He first loved us. But why would we need love if we were never once separated from a relationship with God? When Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden, they never understood, truly understood love until the fall. Because up until that point, they only knew one thing. They only knew one thing, a relationship with God. But once that was taken away, they realized what they lost. They never understood there was something else. And when they did, what did? They hid from God. And then what did God do? God showed them the greatest love. And He said, listen, there's going to be a Messiah. He's going to come. And He's going to make this relationship right. We understand God's love because He first loved us by dying on the cross for us. That's how we experience love. But if we never knew that we were lacking a relationship, we would never know we needed a relationship. I cannot remember well my life before Katie. I don't know how I managed my life before I met Katie. It's just a blur. What I do know is since Katie has come in my life, things are just wonderful. Yeah, there's hard times, but things are wonderful because I experience what unconditional love is. We understand what unconditional love is and how great it is because we know what it is not to be loved. At one time, we were lost. So, what does hate involve? If we understand love, we need to understand hate. And this is what hate involves, is the focus is on you. Look at King Saul. Why did he want to kill David? Because God was with him and not with Saul. Saul wanted to kill David because the presence of God left Saul and went to David, and he was jealous. He was jealous of David, and so he said, I'm going to throw a spear in that boy. He was jealous because God was taking away the kingdom and giving it to David. Hate focuses on you, not on others. If you want to know if you have hate in your heart, are you focusing on you, your needs, your wants, your desires, your preferences? If you are, that's hate. That's all that is. Selfishness is hate. Hate is not understood. Hate is misunderstandings. It starts out with a misunderstanding. You think you heard something. Good example. I was telling Lewis this just today. Katie's not here, so I'm using her as illustrations left and right. So she won't watch this, I hope. So, well, Katie called me the other day. She was in the living room. She's calling me, and I didn't respond because I didn't hear her. Dishwasher's running. I have a little vacuum, a robot vacuum I call Sally. Sally's running around the kitchen cleaning up my mess. It's great having little robots to do my business. And Katie's calling me. Well, finally, I'm walking to the dining room. I hear her, and I go, yes. She's like, why didn't you hear? I'm like, whoa, I didn't hear you. I'm like, I don't have good hearing. I didn't hear you. And she was upset. Hate starts that way. It starts out with misunderstandings. You look at Facebook, and there was all this drama on Facebook with one of the pastors of in our church, in our association, or in our town. And people were just being all different kinds of nasty. And I'm like, what is going on? Why? A misunderstanding. Hate starts out with misunderstandings. Instead of a misunderstanding, if you don't know something, come and ask. Clear it up. If all of a sudden Jamie has a problem with me because he thinks I said he looks funny with a beard. But in fact, I said I like his beard. I wish I could grow one. But he now hates me because, oh, I can't believe you talk about my beard that way. Well, that's just foolishness. Well, so we have a conflict because of misunderstanding. If you think someone has a problem with you, instead of letting it stand, go to them. Find out because it might be a misunderstanding. Also, we get upset with people for unknown wrongs that we don't even know that we wronged them or they feel that they've been wronged. You know, I don't know why John stopped buying mint creamer for the coffee. I guess John doesn't like you. So Becky tells Barbara, you know, I think our pastor hates me. He doesn't even buy me my mint creamer anymore. I know I told him to buy me creamer. Well, I totally forgot, didn't know about it, so now Becky hates me because of mint creamer, because I ignore her needs. And he starts spreading that John hates Becky. Misunderstandings. Misunderstandings. I didn't even know. Now, that didn't really happen, don't worry. But hate is many times started because it's a misunderstanding, an unknown wrong. Hate involves others. Hate is not understood, and hate is a choice. We choose to hate. We choose to hate. Just like we can choose to love, we can choose to hate, we can choose not to hate. It's always the wrong choice, and hate carries a heavy, heavy cost. Hate is a loss of relationship with God. How can we say we love God and hate our brother? That's what 1 John tells us, 1 John 4. We cannot do it. You cannot hate and have a relationship with God. So if you do hate, you don't have a relationship with God. It's impossible. Not only do we lose our relationship with God, we lose our relationship with other people. And finally, hate has results. It changes our lives to lives of happiness, to a life of bitterness. And it hurts others. Think about David, or Saul, Jonathan, and David. Saul's relationship with his dad was fractured, and it never healed. Saul's relationship with David caused David great hurt. Saul's hatred for David caused David and Jonathan, who loved each other more than brothers, their two united souls, caused them to be separate from each other until Jonathan died. Love unites. Hate divides. It hurts. It causes bitterness. But I would say that I would be very, very shocked if anyone here hates. I don't think we hate. I don't think our church has people that hate. But you know what I do think? I think the problem is like. We don't hate. We like. Many times, we choose a love. But other times, we don't choose to hate because we know it's wrong. We choose to like. Just like when Christians don't want to cuss, they say other words, darn. Or they say, freaking, oh. But we're just replacing one with the other. We're doing the same thing here. Instead of saying, well, I don't hate them, I just like them. No. Like is the enemy of love and the friend to hate. We don't show either love or hate, we show like, indifference. But when we do that, we're not showing love, and we're told to love one another, the greatest commandment. Jesus asks, what is the greatest commandment? What is the one thing I should do? And Jesus, they really stumble, he says, the whole Bible can be summed up like this. Love the Lord God with all your heart, strength, and might. And love your neighbor as you love yourself. We are commanded to love. We are not commanded to like. Like is not going far enough. It's like you're told to walk out of the church and you walk all the way through the vestibule, but you don't leave the church. You're not doing it. You almost did, but you didn't do it. You cannot love if you just like. Like is the enemy of love. And this is where I think we are. This is where I think many of us stay, is that we like, we don't love. We do not hate the lost. I would be shocked. I would be shocked if any of you say you hated the lost. Man, those unchristians, man, I hate them. Man, I don't want them here. I don't want to talk to them. I don't want to see them. I hate the lost. Now, if that's just a video clip that gets on YouTube, and that's the only thing, that'd be horrible. I do not hate the lost. But many times, we do not love the lost. Many times, we like the lost. We don't want to see them go to hell. We want to see them get saved. We pray for them. But you know what we don't do? We don't share the gospel with them when we see them. Who here, by raise of hands, who here has saw a lost person this week? If you encountered someone who's not a Christian, raise your hand. We all have encountered someone who's not a Christian. At a grocery store, gas station, the mall, work, we all encountered a lost soul. If we did not share the gospel with them, we liked them, but we did not love them. Why? If someone is dying and you had a chance to rescue them, wouldn't you rescue them? If you're at a beach and someone is drowning and there is a lifeguard there not seeing you, would you not tell a lifeguard, that person is drowning? Would you not throw them a life jacket? Would you not do something to save someone? Of course we would. But when we see the lost, we do not witness them, we do not share the gospel with them, we say, you can go to hell, I'm not going to share the saving gospel of Jesus Christ with you. We like the lost, we do not love the lost. Light is the enemy of love and the friend of hate. If you love the lost, you would share the gospel with them. Well, you might say, John, how do I do that? How do I share the gospel with them? I don't have time to share the gospel with them. In the back of our church, we have a bunch of tracts, we have life books, we have different ways for you to share the gospel with them. You can invite them to church. Invite them to Wednesday night. We have different programs. Many times, we like the lost and not love the lost. Many times, we like the lost and not love the lost. We don't hate the church. I don't think anyone would say they hate this church. But the question is, do we love the church? What does it mean to love the church? We want the church to be successful. We want to see the ministries in the church be successful. But yet we don't get involved the way we should. We don't use our spiritual gifts the way we should. We have mission opportunities, but we do not take them. We do not give the way we need to give. We like the church. We don't love the church. Because what is love? Self-sacrifice. If we are to love the church, we're to get involved in the church in every way possible. Our Sunday school program should have just as many people as our worship program. Our Wednesday night program should have just as many people as our Sunday program. But yet, we like our church, but sometimes we're not willing to love the church. We do not hate other believers. As I said, I do not believe anyone here hates another person. It would shock me to find out that Pam hated someone. It would shock me. But yet, we don't get along with everybody. We get annoyed easily by other people. There's certain people that we just don't want to hang out with. There's certain people that we can't stand. We don't hate them. We just like them. We tolerate them. Again, we're not showing them love. Love is putting your needs, your desires in the back seat and someone else's desires in the front seat. I think that we get complacent and fine and satisfied with like. Because we're not hating, but the problem is we're not loving either. We are told to love one another. Do you love the lost? Are you sharing the gospel as many times as you possibly can? Or do you like the lost? Do you love the church? Or do you just like the church? Do you love other people? Do you love your brothers and sisters in Christ? Or do you like your brothers and sisters in Christ? It's easy to say that we love. But the question is, when it comes to lost, if you're not sharing with the gospel with them, you're liking them. When it comes to church, if you're not serving the church with your time, money, or prayers, you're liking the church, not loving the church. When it comes to other people, other believers, the people in this church, if you're not serving them with them, if you're not praying for them, if you're not welcoming them, if you're not doing everything you can to love them, you're liking them. Do not fall into the trap of like. Go that one step further and love. Witness to the lost. Serve the church. And truly Put other people's needs before your own, and then we will love. Do you love, or are you stuck in the trap of life? Let's pray. Father God, it's so easy to like. It's easy to like because you don't have to go as far as self-sacrifice. You don't have to go out of your comfort zone. You're able to say, at least I don't hate, but let us throw off the mantle of like and put on the mantle of love. Let us love the lost and share the gospel with them. Let us love our church and show up when the doors are open, give the way you want us to give, and serve the way you want us to serve. Let us love other believers, serving them above our own needs. Let us throw aside like and grasp love, as David and Jonathan did. We ask this